My name is Mark McIver. My business name is SliderCuts. I'm a barber who cuts hair for the public. I cut everyone from children to adults to aunties and uncles and granddads. I'm an unofficial counselor, advisor, you know, therapist, because being a barber is so much more than just cutting hair if you're doing it right. Customers feel relaxed and comfortable when they're in your chair, so they feel comfortable to open up and just speak to you about things. I was 14 years old when I picked up the clippers. I think it was very helpful to pick up the clippers that early because I was my first client and I gave myself a lot of bad haircuts where I used to get dissed for, but I went through all of that for years. Then I started cutting my own hair good when I was about 16, 17, and then I've been cutting my hair that whole time. Starting early in the road that you're sticking to, I think it's a very good thing because you get all these years of experience. It's not a bad thing to chop and change careers, but if you're in the same career from when you're like 14, 12 years old, as an example, and then I'm 32 now, and you're still doing the same thing, hopefully you should have mastered your craft with that length of time that you've put into it. A typical day in my life ranges because of Sunday and Monday, I don't work. So typical Sunday and Monday is different from a typical Tuesday to Saturday when I'm working. So let's go with my working days. Wake up early. Most of the time I'm up about 4 or 5, between 4 and 6 some point, to get ready to go to work. Come to work, do a couple Insta stories, you know, morning guys and stuff like that. Then cut hair back to back till evening at some point. Go home, if I get home on time, bath my son, put him to bed, and then spend a little bit of time with my wife. Although recently, to be honest, I've just been sleeping. As soon as I stop, I just sleep. Other factors come into it, like I might be on a call out, which means during the day I might have to pop out from the shop to go and do a haircut, or sometimes after work. But that's kind of like a typical day. On my weekends, on a Sunday, recent times, I wake up with my son about 6 a.m., 5 to 6 a.m. I chill with him for about 2 hours to 3 hours. Then my wife wakes up at 8 because she's with him all week. So on a Sunday, the least I could do is, you know, let her have a little bit of a break. When she wakes up, then I go for a run. Then come back, then me and my wife and my son, we go to church. Some have said that I'm an entrepreneur, and I wouldn't like disagree with that. I think I get that from probably my mom. Because when we were younger, like, my mom used to sell chin chin. For those Nigerians and maybe Ghanaians, West African, you should know what chin chin is. She also used to sell plantain crisps. She used to make them and sell them. And she used to have like me and my brothers in the kitchen. Like, it sounds dodgy, you know, weighing it, bagging it, labeling it, sealing it. And then we had to deliver it to shops who she was selling it to. My mom was always trying something, doing something, you know, even up to today. And when I mean always working, doing something. Like, you know, when I was younger, she owned a shop. My mom's shop got burgled. Now, when I say burgled, actually all her supplies, like the stock room, like everything got taken, and she had to start again. And she had 4 kids. We were actually homeless because she lost everything. She lost the shop. But then she just never stopped. Like, she was always trying and she was always working. I feel like for how hard I work, when people are like, you know, you're really, really a hard worker, I guess if I look at my life on a whole and think, where did I get that from? It has to be my mom, because she's a hard worker. Like, she doesn't stop. People, like my wife, like to sometimes say, you know, I'm a busybody, you know, like, and I feel like, yeah. And my mom, what's funny enough is, growing up, my mom would always use that term, like, you know, busybody, you know, you're just a busybody, busybody. And it's like, well, probably because you're a busybody. What made me get into barbering was not having no money to go to the barber shop. That was it. My mom never had the money to send us to the barber shop. My mom probably didn't respect the idea of going to pay for a haircut when in her mind, she could do it herself. Because she used to just cut our hair off, skin. Like, I remember being in primary school, our haircut was a bald head. And it wasn't probably a clean bald head either. It was probably a patchy bald head.
Oh.
And the funny thing is, I remember being in primary school and every time we got a haircut, a teacher would always have this thing where they'd be like, oh, you've got a haircut.
Wow.
Looks nice. And I remember it was always that hesitation, because realistically, you've just seen this kid with like hair, how yours was before you came in, yeah. And now it's bald.
Yeah.
And you're like a 9-year-old kid. A song that best describes my work ethic. It's funny, because I've never actually really listened to this song. There was a stage when it was just always on, and it was Every Day I'm Hustling.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm, every day I'm.
Because I do feel like every single day, you know, I'm hustling, you know, I'm not walking on kind of like an even pavement. It's like, it's just a hustle and bustle of things. I'm always trying, I'm always pushing, I'm always trying to seek something new. I'm not happy enough getting to a place and just saying, okay, well, I've completed this now, now we're done, just chill. Like, I'm always kind of like, okay, what's the next thing? As soon as I get to, you know, the end of the road, it's kind of like, okay, well, we can climb over this wall, we can go around this wall, what's behind it, you know, what more can we do? So it feels like every day I'm hustling, you know, cutting hair and then all the other things I'm trying to do in my life, which is to do with my brand of SliderCuts, you know, the products, you know, got the t-shirts, the barbershop, you know, just if everything which I'm trying to do, you know, I feel like it's every day, it's like it's a hustle. The kind of child I was in the classroom, energy, I guess. I always wanted to do something. I was always kind of like, I guess I was hyperactive, but not super hyperactive. But I just had a lot of energy. I mucked about a little bit, but I was never like a bad kid. Growing up in a strict Nigerian home, there was still always the idea of respect for your elders and stuff like that. But I was always like joking around, me and my friends, just jokes. And I went to St. Aloysius Secondary School. And if anybody knows that school, they know that it's really known for its banter. So it was just a lot of banter in the classroom. I feel that has carried through into my adulthood. Like, so we're talking about from when I was like 12 years old to 16. And now I'm 32 years old. And anybody who knows me, especially in the barbershop, will just know that it's always jokes. You know, it's always banter. It's not taking life too seriously. And I feel like that part of my life in secondary school especially carried through to my adulthood. I believe in keeping elements of the child in you. As a child, you have no responsibilities. I don't think it's a good thing to be a childish adult, but I don't think it's a good thing to be an over-serious adult. So I feel like there's a balance. I feel like, you know, the same way when you go to a playground, you see kids just running about and just having fun. I think that youthfulness is something that shouldn't leave us. Like, I think you shouldn't get to the point where you don't have fun no more, where you think it's wrong to run, it's wrong to laugh, it's wrong to smile. Like, you know, I really believe, you know, the way children see life, sometimes I think adults need to take a leaf out of their book and just, you know, follow that same suit. Advice I'd give to those which are starting off in the barber field, based off what I've done, don't chase money. First thing, don't chase money. Like, I'll say it once again, do not chase money. Now, it might be hard for some, especially if you're older and you have responsibilities, like, you know, you're living by yourself, you got to pay rent, you have a wife, you have a child, you know, or you have a husband, whatever, you just have responsibilities in life. So it makes it hard not to chase money. But I will say this, if you chase perfecting your craft, money will come. Everybody wants a good barber. So if you're a good barber, people will be willing to pay for that service. So often I see people which are kind of like, I need money now, I need money now, I need money now. And it's like, you're chasing money. So as example, they'll do things like, you got a customer in your chair who's paying you however much they're paying you, you know, and another customer walks in. And because you want to get to that customer quickly, you rush one customer out the chair, but then you don't give that customer the haircut he wants. But in that moment, you've made double what you would have made if you'd have spent time on a haircut, but you might have just lost a customer. So for the next, you know, he might be coming every 2 weeks. So as example, let's go with the idea of £10. So you made £20 from cutting two people right now, but then you've lost £10 every 2 weeks for the foreseeable future. So that's why it's like, I'm always like, in the beginning stages, don't even think about the money, just think about bettering your craft. When I started, I was cutting hair for free, and I'd go to people's house and cut their hair for free. And what was good about that was I was getting experience. And also the good thing is, if I'm cutting your hair for free, you can't be that angry if I don't give you a good haircut, because this haircut's free, you know. So I'll give that advice to people, like, just really work on being a good barber, learn from those who are better than you, be honest with yourself. Another major thing, so let's go with it. First major thing, do not chase money, chase perfecting your craft. Number two, be honest with yourself. And what I mean by being honest with yourself is, you should be able to look at a haircut and say, you know, that's a good haircut. You should be able to see your own haircut and say, you know what, this is a good haircut for me, but it's not where it's supposed to be. So don't lie to yourself. Don't kind of get to the place where it's like, this is the best, this is great, this is blah, blah, blah. Now, this is good for me, and you should be happy in that. But you should be able to look at that and say, well, it's not on the standard of where I want to be, you know? And that's what I mean by be honest with yourself, you know, be honest with your skill, be honest with where you're at. Having a team is vital in this field. And when I mean having a team, having people you can talk to, people you can take advice from, people who you can watch, but having a team is not essential. You can do it without a team. You know, especially in this day and age, there are so many resources, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Like, you can have a virtual team, because there's so many barbers who are online who are giving advice. Like, I do YouTube videos where I give tutorials and give advice and stuff like that. I do Insta Lives where I answer people's questions and stuff like that. Up and coming barbers often ask me questions through Instagram, you know, Facebook and stuff like that. That's a virtual team, really. So team is vital, but it's not essential in a sense to have a physical team around you, because we got so many resources in this day and age. And I'll just tell people to really lean on those resources. Like, use your Instagram, search for good barbers, watch them. Go on YouTube, look at the tutorials, watch them, you know, ask questions. If you ask someone a question and they don't respond, then just ask again. If they don't respond, ask again. And if they don't respond, ask again. Like, you know, there's no harm in it. That's kind of like getting started. But let's say with where I'm at now, I feel like I came to a place recent times, maybe a year ago, where I realized that in order to make, you know, slider cuts what I want to make it, I need help. So I need a team. I need, you know, an assistant to help me out. I just need help. So a team is really helpful, because you can share the load. Like, I've got all of these ideas in my head of things I want to do, and I haven't got enough time to do it all. But you can't always rely on a team. So even if the team isn't there, you just do the best you can. And that's what I've done. Like, before I even hired an assistant 6 months ago, I've been doing everything myself and doing it to the best of my ability. You get to a point where you just feel like, you know, can I go forward, or am I exhausting all of my resources, you know, and all of my energy? And, you know, that's when I expanded. Team is vital, but it's not essential. I think it's important to know who you are. And when I mean knowing who you are, it's kind of like knowing who you are, knowing your capabilities, knowing where you're at, as well as striving for who you want to be. I feel like there's a big confusion where people look online, especially now in this generation we're in, where you can look at your counterparts in halfway across the world and see them, like, you know, he's the same age as me and he's making, you know, billions of dollars or pounds or euros or whatever it is, and really get kind of like almost depressed over the idea of seeing these visuals of this person's doing this person's doing that, this person's there, I want to be there. So I really think it's really important to be grounded and to be just be honest with where you're at and where you want to be. And to break that down, to explain what I mean, is you can look online and see a barber, he's got however many followers, he gets however many likes, he gets however many comments, he's renowned, he's this, he's that, and you could be there talking about, I want to be there, I want to be that, I want to be that, I want to be that, why am I not that? And it's just kind of like you're focusing kind of the wrong things. To say I want to be there just because he gets loads of comments and loads of likes, I think, you know, you're now chasing the wrong thing. It's not about the craft anymore. But I always feel like the focus should be on the craft. So really, see, the idea should more be him looking at his work and saying, right, I like his work, I want to be that good. He's a good speaker, I want to be that good at speaking. Like, I feel like we're chasing the wind. We're chasing like things like, oh, I want likes, I want comments, I want followers, but why? And that's why, I mean, you really get to ask yourself that question, but why? And being honest. And it might just be because you want to be a celebrity, because you want to be known. And if that's the real reason as to why you want these things there, then there's plenty of things you can do. Things I won't agree with myself, but there's plenty of things you can do to get likes. There are plenty of things you can do to get comments. There's plenty of things you can do to get followers. I wouldn't particularly agree with all these things there, but if that's where your motivation is, then you can just do that. But if you're chasing the craft, it should be, I like that guy's work. I want to be that good. I like the way that guy talks. I want to talk as well as him and better. I like the way he puts himself out there. I want to put myself out there as well as him or her. Because there's plenty of female barbers, plenty of guy barbers as well. You know, I like that person's work. And I feel like when you start chasing those things there, I feel that, you know, there'll be a real substance in the followers you have. There'll be a real substance in the likes and the comments which you have, you know, because you're chasing the right things. And even if you never get to where that person is, you can only be the best you. The fastest person in the world, Usain Bolt. There can only be one person who's the fastest person in the world. Am I going to be depressed because I'm not faster than Usain Bolt? Nonsense. Be the best you. If the fastest I can run 100 meters is in 15 seconds and I put all the work into it and that's the fastest I can run it, then I should be happy with that because I've done the best I can do. This whole thing where people are constantly after other people's success, that's why so many people are depressed, because we all can't be the best. We all can't be at that level. I agree with positivity and stuff like that, but it has to be balanced out in reality. You cannot be the best at everything. You can just be the best you. That's my brother's slogan. My brother, PMAT Fitness, he's a personal trainer. And that's his slogan, be the best you. Because he's saying that when I train you, I'm going to make you the best you. I'm not going to make you to be Anthony Joshua. I'm not going to make you to be this person. I'm not going to make you to be me or whoever it is. I'm going to make you the best version of you. And that's what I'm just saying people need to do and start focusing on and stop getting depressed because you're not better than him. So what? You're not better than him. So being depressed, what's that gonna do? Is that gonna make you better than this other person? And that's why with me in my career, I'm just trying to be the best me. And wherever that takes me, it takes me. Like, I have this thing, me and my wife always talk about this. And it's this whole thing, because obviously, because I'm a Christian and I believe in God, it's the idea of we just throw our seeds and God waters the ones he wants to water. Simple. I can only throw my seeds. So I'm gonna try being a barber. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. Simple, God didn't water it. I'm gonna try to do this clothing thing. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. God didn't water it. I'm gonna try to do some products. It doesn't work. God didn't water it. But I'm just gonna do what I can. And that's, you know, I'm just throwing my seeds and, you know, God is the one who controls the water, you know. And, you know, he's controlling which ones is the best ground and best, you know, soil and stuff like that, you know. So I can only do what I can do. And I guess my advice to people, just do what you can do and be happy with where you get. As long as you know that you've tried your best and you've put everything you can into it, then what more could you do? I think it's important to be integral, to be a nice person on your journey up to the top. Do I think it's actually essential to be a nice person and to be integral to be successful in business? No, you don't need to be. You don't need to be a nice person. You don't need to be integral. You don't need to be any of these things whatsoever. But it's all about what you're chasing. So when we talk about success and we talk about making it to the top, it's about what you're chasing. You know, the top is what you're looking at. As example, you want to be a good barber, then that is your success, being a good barber. But then even then, it's all relative, because like, what's a good barber? You might say, I'm a good barber now, then there might be 100 barbers who say, yo, you're rubbish. If you want to make £10 million, do you need to be a nice person or integral to make £10 million? No. And if that's your goal, by any means necessary, you want to make £10 million, you don't need to be a nice person to make £10 million. You don't need to be integral to make £10 million. You can be dodgy, you can be a horrible person, you can have no friends, but that's what you're chasing. You just want £10 million. But for me personally, for what I'm trying to do in life, do I want to be a nice guy along the way? 100%. Do I want to be integral? 100%. Because what I'm chasing isn't simply, oh, just being a good barber and just creating a brand, you know, that is known by everyone. I want it to be integral. I want people, when they mention SliderCuts, to put it alongside the idea of reliable, trustworthy, integral, honest, polite. I want all of these kind of things to be attached to the brand, because it's more than just giving people a haircut with what I'm doing. Like, I really want to help out the community. And that's why, you know, we started this program with the young runners, which are like between 13 years old and 16 years old, where we get young boys from around the community which need help in different things. So it's not always kind of like, oh, he's about to sell drugs. Sometimes it is, you know, he's on the roads and he's doing this. Although sometimes it is. Sometimes it's like, you know, this person just needs help because he's just really low on confidence, you know, so we're helping him out with that. This person's just a rude young boy, so we're helping him out with that. This person needs guidance because he wants to be a barber, so we're helping him out with that. This person wants to, you know, just, there's just so many different aspects. We're just trying to help the community. So the whole idea of, like, you know, being a horrible person and doing it by any means necessary is not something I would carry with my brand. For what I'm trying to reach isn't, oh, I just want to make £10 million, or I just want to be seen by everyone. There's a lot more substance to it. There's a reason. So the goals aren't money. The goals are actually kind of like objects. I want to help the community. I want to become a well-known brand, make good merchandise and products that, you know, work for people. Then alongside that, money will come. But the goal isn't, I want to make this much money. The goal is, I want to put out a good product. I want to give out a good haircut. I want to help the youth, you know, in the community. I want to help people, not only youth, people which are my age. Naturally, with some of these things I'm doing, money follows. So being a nice guy, being integral, for me, is vital and essential. But to be successful, you don't need to be a nice guy. You don't need to be any of these things there, because success is what you deem it to be as well. Because you might say, what do you call it? Oh, success to me is £100, and you make £100 and you're successful. And no one can tell you you're not successful. Like, no one can say to you, no, you're not successful. And if someone says that to you, ask them why. They say, oh, you never made £1,000. I didn't want to make £1,000. I want to make £100. I once heard this thing, right? The game, the rapper. I was watching an interview with him. They asked him, like, you know, you seem to be very charitable because he gives away a lot of money and tips a lot of people at restaurants and does all these things, right? And they're just like, you know, like, I kind of asked him, where does this come from? And he was just like, when I was younger, all I wanted was a Mercedes car or something like that, a certain car he wanted. I think a house, to buy his mom a house or something along that. It was just a few things. And that's what I was chasing after. He goes, I've got all those things there. So he goes, everything else he gets to him is just kind of excess and a bonus. So can Bill Gates look down on him and say he hasn't been successful? I don't think he can. He achieved the things he wanted to achieve. Don't measure your success against someone else's success. Like, have your goals of what you want to do, you know, and achieve those things and aim to achieve those things. And even if you don't achieve those things, don't let these things, like, leave you depressed, because you can only do what you can do. letting go of fear has been so important, because fear for me is like a weight, or like a rope that's, you know, like a weight that's, you know, that's holding you down, or a rope that's tied around you. So as you're trying to walk forward, fear is the thing that's kind of pulling you back. What does fear change? Fear doesn't change your situation. Like, I've had haircuts where I'm just nervous, and nervousness is really just fearful. I'm fearful, I'm cutting this person's hair. Hair is hair. Whether or not I'm cutting the richest man in the world or the poorest man in the world, hair is hair. What am I fearful about? If I can cut hair, I can cut hair. I'll give you a few examples. Cutting LeBron James's hair. I was cutting his hair and I was nervous and I was fearful and I was praying. I was like, oh God, please, please don't let me mess this up. And you know, please this and that. And the voice to counteract the fear was simply, hair is hair. Like, fear is not gonna do anything positive in this haircut. You can only do what you're gonna do. So, and fear, if anything, is gonna hinder that haircut, because you're gonna be sweating, you're gonna be shaking a little bit. You just got to trust your ability. Even if you do something wrong, if something bad happens, it happens. But was fear gonna prevent that? So yeah, you know, it happens all the time. Like, you know, cutting so many different celebrities, you know, you go to cut someone for the first time, you know, Tiny Temper, you know, Anthony Joshua, just a list of other people, you know, Stormzy, you know, whoever it is, you know, you're going to cut these guys and it's kind of like, okay, rah, the pressure's on now, you know, time to live up to what they think of you. But then you just got to speak reason into that and speak the truth into that situation. These guys have only come to you based off the work that you put out there. Now, if you haven't been deceptive and you put out real work of yourself, then they want to cut with you because of the work they've seen. And that's the reason why when I started like this whole journey, like the journey started like, you know, 18 years ago, but when I started the whole journey, when I was putting out work and haircuts and stuff like that, I remember saying to myself, I'm going to put out what I actually do. There are haircuts I put on my Instagram, which I actually look at and say, ah, I could have done that better. That shape up could have been sharper. That beard could have been neater. There's some hair sticking out, but I still put it out there. And you know the reason why? Because I let that person walk out with that haircut. So that is my work. And because I put out work that I actually do, like consistently, and I remember speaking to a barber about this, and I remember saying to, talking about it, saying, you know what? I'm just gonna put out loads of work, like whether I think it's the best or not, I'm just gonna put out loads of work. Because I want people to see, I want Instagram to be a real true reflection of who I am as a barber. So even if I don't think it's the best, I'm gonna still put it out. And remember, he said to me, he didn't agree with that because, you know, if you go to any restaurant or McDonald's or whoever it is, they put out the best picture of the way their products look. Even though when you get a Big Mac as example, it doesn't look like the Big Mac in a picture. If you go to any restaurant, you know, the pictures look a lot better than what they actually are. I don't want that. I don't want someone to come to me and say, rah, your pictures are better than you. That's not good. And I remember he said he didn't agree with it, but I said, that's the road I'm going down. So that when I come across cutting whoever it is, I don't have to be nervous because they like my work and I haven't been deceptive. I haven't just put out one picture a month of the best haircut I've done this month. I'm putting out pictures every single day. If you've been putting out pictures of haircuts that you haven't done, or I put out hair, if I was to put out pictures of haircuts I didn't do, pretending to be my work, then you know what? I should be fearful. I have a right to be fearful when I go and cut Barack Obama, you know, Jay-Z, Kanye West, whoever it is, you know, Stormzy, Def Curry, whoever it is, Tiny Temper, because I've sold them a false me. It's not me. But if you have, like, you know, walked this road correctly, then don't be fearful. Like, fear's not doing anything for you. I used to dance. I used to MC. I used to act. So at the age of like 13, 14 probably, I started MCing and I started dancing because there was a boy in my classroom who came in, he came from Australia and he could like body pop, you know, wave pop and all that kind of stuff there. And wave, and I was like, wow. I started going to a dance class, like, you know, body popping, and just did that for a few years. Then I went to a street dance class and I did that till about the age of like 20, 21, maybe 22. My MC name was Slider, although I had a few other names. One of my MC names before was Gallus. Now the funny story about Gallus is I never got no girls, which is one, because for those who don't understand what a Gallus is like a ladies man. But I never got no girls, which is one. I called myself Anonymous, Thriller, there must have been a couple other, till I got to the name Slider. And that was my MC name. I MC'd from probably about 14 till about 18, 19 probably, that age there. That stopped. I was doing acting. I went to Sylvia Young, some of you might know it, Sylvia Young Drama School. I did performing arts in college. I was cutting hair from 14 years old. So I was doing all these things side by side. When I became like a barber, like 18 years old, when I started working in a shop, D&L's barbershop, and I was kind of like doing an internship, you could call it. I was still doing all these various other things. So it was like, what was my focus? And I never had a full focus because it's kind of like I want to dance, I want to sing, I want to, you know, I want to cut hair. I was doing it all at the same time. I was putting my energy into all of them. Was I doing things half-heartedly? No. I would work all day as a barber, then I'd go to voice class. But basically, I was just like filling my whole time with everything. When I was doing my barbering, I was taking that seriously as well. And the reason why, because a lot of people say, you know, unless you really fully commit to something, you shouldn't maybe take it that seriously, or you shouldn't put your all in. For me, I don't agree with that, because I feel like if you're doing something, just do it properly. So I was studying barbering, and when I mean studying barbering, I was watching the barbers who were better than me, Damon, Frankie. Like, I used to watch these guys and just like sit here all day with no clients and just watch them. So these are the type of hard parts, which you could call moment of wonder. I'd be sitting here, I was like 19 years old, and I'd be sitting here the whole day just watching the other barbers cut hair. I'd come in at 9 o'clock on a Saturday, I'd leave at 6 or 7 whenever we closed, and I wouldn't have cut one person, but I was just watching everyone else cutting hair. I remember thinking to myself, you know, I wanna get there. Now, I never had this thought where it's like, oh, I'm just gonna quit. I understood and accepted the process. Like, this isn't overnight. And so what if Damon's cutting 10,000 people and I'm cutting 2 people a week? I'm not in that place yet. Too many people are racing with people which have started the race way before them. How can I be in a marathon and, you know, one of the marathon runners is on mile 20 and I've just started it and I'm angry a mile in because I'm not in the same place as him? When you think about it like that, logically, it doesn't make any sense. I'm on mile 1, so yeah, you know, I've done mile 1 in, you know, 8 minutes or 9 minutes or whatever it is, or 10 minutes, whatever it is. It's like, cool, that's where I'm at. You know, I will get to mile 20, you know, in however long. So I've never had this kind of like this thing where it's kind of like I'm constantly looking at other people and where they're at and being jealous of where they're at. I have admired where these people are and I have strived, you know, to get to where they are. So like Damon, Frankie left and Damon was here. I looked at him and I was just like, you know what? I want to be as good as Damon. Like, I want to do a fade the way he does it. I want to get my haircuts looking like his. And it was just a chase and a chase and a chase. And then as I was getting closer, it's kind of like, you know, well, now I'm getting closer, it's kind of like I can now see past him. So, you know, how can I be better than him? And this isn't to say, oh, wow, am I better than him or not? You know, it's not nothing like that. But it's just that whole process of being like, you know, not, you know, running before I can even crawl. You know, so everyone has these moments where you're not cutting hair. Like, you know, sometimes with some of the trainee barbers we brought in, I see them sometimes and you see them moody. It's like, oh, I'm not getting no clients, this and that. And it's just like, bruv, like, why are you so moody? Like, do you think this happens overnight? Like, do you think that I was never there not cutting no hair? Back when I was doing it, Damon was kind of like more do your thing. So if I didn't cut hair throughout the day, Damon wasn't coming to me talking about, you know, rah, you know, maybe tomorrow there'll be more customers or anything like that. It was more of a harder generation where it's kind of like, so? So, you know, I've been through the times where you're not cutting any hair, and even I'm a couple years in. And now I feel like I'm a good barber, but Damon still got loads more customers than me. Frankie still had loads more customers than me before he left. But I just did what I had to do. Studied, watched them, looked at them, did my work, and kept on striving to be better. I got to a place where I dropped out dancing, I dropped out MCing, doing acting, and I had this desire that I wanted to help people. So I wanted to do a social work course, and I did a foundation in social work when I was about 24. I also did a personal training course, so I'm a qualified PT, and I was doing all these different things, right? But at the same time, I never stopped putting my full energy into barbering. Even though it wasn't known to me I wanted to do barbering fully, but I still worked hard and I still kind of like studied it and did what I was supposed to do. Because I don't agree with the attitude of, well, since you don't know, don't put your work in. I don't agree with that. Is this like the example of like saying being in a relationship and saying I'm gonna be in this relationship, but I'm not gonna be fully committed because I don't know if I wanna be in this relationship or not. So I'm gonna have one foot out. That could be seen in different ways of like, you know, oh, I'm not going to give my heart. I'm not going to cook for this person because I'm only gonna give that when I'm fully committed. I'm not going to see this person as often as I should. I'm not going to say how I feel to this person. But I just don't agree with that, because my thing is, if you're in that relationship, be in a relationship. And if you get to the point where you don't wanna be in that relationship, then don't be in that relationship. Same thing in your job. If you're in the job, do the job properly. And if you don't wanna do the job, then stop. But I don't agree with having your foot out. Like, no, if you're in it, be in it. So if you're with your partner, be with your partner. If you're not sure, you can be unsure. That's not an issue, but be in that relationship. If you get to a point where you don't want to be in that relationship anymore and you realize for whatever reason, this is not helpful, this and that, whatever your reasons are, then you leave that relationship. But I feel like where some people say, at least I didn't give that person my all. At least I didn't do this, at least I didn't do that. For me, the way I've lived my life, I just give my all, I don't care. You think you can save heartache? Do you feel like it's like, you know, well, I didn't give him my all, so you know, my heart's not aching? Listen, if you've been in any type of relationship, you've been committed to anything, job, this and that, when it ends, there's always some point of sorrow. To try and sit up to avoid these things in life, I think doesn't work. Like if you get sacked tomorrow, and you say, well, at least I wasn't given doing full hours. What, are you now not upset that you've been sacked? So that's why for me, it's just like in everything I kind of go into in life, if I make a decision to go into it, then that's me saying that I'm going to be committed to whatever I'm doing for that period of time or for that time which I'm in it. And that's what I've done with barbering. And why it was so helpful was because when I decided to say, actually, I dropped out everything, I did the personal training thing, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing the social work thing, and I decided to say, yo, I want to be a barber, I'm actually going to actually focus on barbering, I had already built up a good foundation because I had focused on barbering while I was in it, even when I wasn't sure. I decided, and you know what, let me get a name for myself, let me build a website for myself. My nickname was Slider. My wife, my older brother, we were talking about the name I was going to go for. At the time, I was just going to say Slider the Barber. They thought it was a rubbish name and it was dead, but I didn't think it was like a creative name. I just thought at least when people saw the name, they'd know I was a barber. And they were like, they didn't like it. So they were talking. I went out the room, they started talking. And at the same time, they're like, what would be a better name? And they're like, Slider, Slider. And at the same time, they said, Slider, Slider, Slider Cuts. And it was like, yeah. And they're like, listen, we got this name for you instead, Slider Cuts. And I was like, I wasn't sure. I asked around, I thought about it. Then I accepted the name, started my website. And that was before like any barber had a website. Then, you know, social media came out a couple years later, Instagram, Twitter. I started using my Instagram, posting pictures and stuff like that. But it's just been a journey, like, throughout. Like, it hasn't been kind of like, you started up here. No, we all, you know, not all of us start down here. But the majority of us, we start down here and we build up. You know, we all go through the stages of a barber where you don't have customers. You go through the stages when you can't cut hair well. You go through the stages when you're so frustrated because you want to be a better barber, but you can't be a better barber at that moment because it's just not happening overnight. Because it's a process, it's a marathon. You are steadily running this race. It's not a sprint, you don't get there overnight. I have been there where, you know, you're indecisive. Do I wanna be a barber or not? Do I wanna go and do this or not? You know, and then you wanna be a barber and then you're frustrated because, you know, I'm looking at other people's haircuts and I'm like, my fades aren't coming out that way. My shape ups aren't coming out that way. Why doesn't my haircut look right? I can't see what's wrong with it right now, but it's not looking the same way as other people. And this is where it's just about being honest with yourself. I always come back to this, being honest with yourself. If your haircuts aren't coming out the way you want it to come out, then you seek advice. How are you doing that? Why are your fades coming out like that? How do you do that fade? Oh, how do you hold a clipper when you do this? So just being honest and dropping all pride. Like up to today, like one of the things I say, and I've had this prayer with God, like I beg you God, don't ever let pride get in the way of my goals. And meaning, I still watch all the barbers around me. I still learn from all the barbers around me. And I watch them. I'm like, okay, that's a really good fade. And I watch them, okay, how did you do that fade? All right, that's a good technique. I don't ever want to get to this place where I feel like I'm too old or I'm too good to learn. You can always learn. And that's what one of the things I just want to continue to always do. Keep learning, keep watching everyone around you. Never get too big-headed and think you're too big. The thing that has kept me going is staying on path of the goal. And the goal was, I want to be a good barber. And what I found funny in the way that I feel like God kind of just like, it's weird, the way God kind of just like took all these things which I wanted to do and kind of brought it out even in my barbering now, which I never foresaw, was like I wanted to help people. I wanted to even do like things like even like counseling and stuff like that. Courses, and I found myself now almost being a counselor to clients and people, giving them advice, you know, hearing them out. And it's weird because in the beginning, I remember like earlier on when I wanted to be a counselor, which I didn't mention earlier, and I wanted to do social work because I just wanted to help people. I found myself being a barber but still helping people. I was doing performing arts because I enjoyed acting, I enjoyed dancing, I enjoyed singing, I enjoyed being in front of the camera, you know. But then I became a barber and I said, you know, my focus is just going to be being a good barber. And I focused on that. And then, right, I'm in the front of the camera again. Right, I'm basically kind of performing, you know, in a sense of some, like, people don't realize being in front of the camera, not in this kind of situation, because this is kind of like just talking, but when I'm doing like my Insta stories and when you're doing like my tutorials on videos, stuff like that, it's performing because nobody wants to watch you saying, so you do a line, you fade out the line, you do a number one, number two, now we shape up, thanks guys. Nobody wants to see that in camera. You got to perform. And I look at like my acting I've done in my earlier career, and this has helped me. Sometimes in front of the camera, I'm like, yeah, you know, remember, stare at the camera and remember, enunciate yourself. And remember, be clear. And just all of these things which I took from, you know, performing arts. And it's just funny because I feel like God has used all of these things in the foundations of what, you know, of my life, and has used them all in what I'm doing right now. I have a few quotes that, you know, kind of like I live by. Not that I live fully, like my whole life revolves around this one quote, but it's heavily influential in my life. And one of them, I've got my phone in my hand, I'm going to read from my phone because it's a Bible verse. It's Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. And it says, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive your reward of your inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. But he who does wrong will be repaid for what he has done, and there is no partiality. Basically, what it means is the whole idea of whatever you're doing, whatever work you're doing, you should work as if God is your boss. So when it's kind of like your boss isn't looking, so it's like, I can get away with this. I can actually kind of like skip a couple hours out. But knowing that God is watching you, you can't skip a couple hours out. Or you know what, I'm not gonna do this to the best of my ability because you know, who's gonna know? But if God's your boss and he's all knowing, all seeing, he sees what you're doing. So it's the whole idea of like, you know, also just when you're working, forget about like your human bosses and this and that and everyone around you. Do that work, whatever it is, like you are working on to God. And I've used that in my career, even when you're tired, even when you can't be bothered, it's just kind of like, well, you know what? I'm working like I'm working unto God. Like God's always in front of me. If your boss was in front of you all day long, he would get the best work out of you because you know you're scared, you don't want to get fired, you don't want to get reprimanded. So knowing that God is watching you is kind of like, I always encourage you to say, well, do you know what? I'm gonna have to keep the levels up. And I hold on to that kind of quote with my work ethic and with the way I work and the way I live out barbering. My name is Mark McIver, also known as SliderCuts, and you have just seen the wonders of what got me here today.